In the mid-1500s, Japan was in a perpetual state of civil war. When the Ashikaga shogunate was defeated, it created a power vacuum that saw the rise of many numerous independent city-states, or daimyos, rise up to try to take the title of shogun for themselves and institute their own system of government. This resulted in a period referred to historically as the Sengoku Jidai, or Warring States period. In 1560, if you were a betting man, you would have put money on the Imagawa clan to take Kyoto and claim the capital for themselves. But as it turns out, you would have lost that bet because they got absolutely steamrolled by a much smaller clan who just happened to have recently imported firearms. This clan was led by a man who is credited as one of the people responsible for unifying Japan during this time. A man who is an absolute staple of villainized historical figures throughout pop culture and media. A man named Oda Nobunaga. Such a piece of pop culture set in the Sengoku Jidai featuring Nobunaga as its villain will be the subject of today's video. Japan has a very interesting attitude towards depictions of its own history. Over here in the West, a work like Sengoku Basara would probably ruffle some feathers over being so anachronistic and satirical with its source material. Some people would probably see it as disrespectful to history. But Japan seems to kind of endorse this kind of media, with advertisements for Sengoku Basara-related merchandise being featured at tourism locations for actual historical sites like castles. People argue that Japan's pop culture is the result of an intentional and deliberate effort over the last several decades to appear pacified and harmless in a post-World War II culture where the bloodier parts of their history are ignored or denied altogether. But this doesn't really take into account the people that I'm sure live in Japan that think that things like anime and video games are stupid and childish and not a representation of their culture as a whole. But at the end of the day, I'm not someone who's native to Japan, so it's really not my place to say how they feel about their own culture. But I can at least say, even as a dumb American, I like this type of media and I love Sengoku Basara, and I'm very excited to be able to share it with you today. Sengoku Basara is the Musou formula concentrated into its purest form, with the elements that don't work stripped out of it and the ones that do amplified. It's completely ridiculous and over the top, and doesn't make hardly any attempts to take itself seriously. It has a very rebellious, punk attitude about itself, which should honestly be the default when it comes to the Musou genre. Its attempts at historical reference are just enough to inspire some intrigue about the real history, while nearly approaching the territory of total farce in terms of their satirical inaccuracy. The closest it gets to paying homage to real history is with the character names, some aspects of designs, and certain well-known historical battles like Kawa Nakajima and Sekigahara. It otherwise has a very tokusatsu vibe to it, like you're reenacting the Sengoku Jidai with Super Sentai action figures. I already told the story of how I got into the brand, so let's find out, how does the first game hold up? And more importantly, how does it hold up compared to Koei's own Samurai Warriors released 15 months prior? Surprisingly, the production of Sengoku Basara is pretty well documented. Hiroyuki Kobayashi approached the Capcom Board of Directors in winter of 2003, with a proposition for a new kind of action game, the likes of which no one had ever seen before, featuring characters based off real-life warlords from history. This was initially met with pushback considering Capcom had just released Onimusha and didn't think they needed another samurai game. Not to mention they had just been in the red financially for 2 years and were in no mood for risk-taking. Kobayashi insisted that his game would be a lot more accessible to pick up and play and was intended for an entirely different audience from Onimusha. President of Capcom at the time, Kenzo Sugimoto, had faith in Kobayashi and insisted in giving the project a chance. By July of 2004, they had only 10 months remaining to meet their deadline of release, and the team was seriously lacking focus. Apparently there was some internal strife where people within the studio would act very dismissively and condescendingly towards the project and didn't want to be a part of Kobayashi's team, so he had no choice but to appoint a new director to get the project back on track, to which he chose Makoto Yamamoto, and this would be his first project as director. One of Yamamoto's ambitious decisions was to make sure that all 21 characters not only had voice acting, but were played by an all-star cast of voice actors. An expensive and risky decision, I'm sure, but after the team saw the project starting to come together with the voice acting added to the existing gameplay, it finally started to click for them and they all began to believe in the project's success. So, how did it turn out? Well, I feel like at the time of its release, it's the most fun Musou game to date. The Conquest mode borrows a bit from the Empire's Dynasty Warriors games. 16 of the 21 characters are playable, and when you choose one to guide to victory across the warring states, you get to select a stage based on which state is within proximity of your starting location, and after each stage, the tide of war changes and territory is gradually taken over until one warlord has claimed the land of the Rising Sun for themselves. The random element of who wins these off-screen skirmishes can mean two different playthroughs of the Conquest mode can have radically different outcomes. If there's a design element in games that I am a sucker for, it's having a random AI element that artificially adds a ton of replay value to a game that otherwise has little content. But that only works if the core gameplay loop is fun. So what is the core gameplay loop and how does it deviate from the formula that originated in Dynasty Warriors 2? So you have your regular attack combo by mashing square and two different heavy attack finishers called arts you can swap between and use with triangle. Each character unlocks a few of these as they level up and you can customize your loadout of moves before entering a new battle, along with new weapons and equipment which really just adds some minor stat differences and aren't particularly important to the gameplay. It was the standard design philosophy with Capcom at the time with games like Devil May Cry and Onimusha that action games needed to be challenging, and that was what appealed to their players. Kobayashi rejected this notion and opted for a much more accessible game. However, Basara does have an ultimate difficulty mode that I highly recommend, and it's on this difficulty that the combat and level design really begins to shine, the only downside being the boss fights against the other warlords. Musou games can never quite get these right, and you usually just end up awkwardly exchanging blows and hoping that you win this war of attrition. There's no lock-on feature in this game, which isn't necessary, but it's definitely appreciated in the Musou games that do include it. There's great variety to the characters as well, with widely different fighting styles and weapons, while also managing to keep its roster of characters historically relevant and making sense for who they are. Characters also have elemental affinities, which was becoming standard in Dynasty Warriors games around this time, but it almost never comes up in gameplay. Sometimes a fire character might set someone on fire, which causes damage over time, or a lightning character may stun another character, but you can largely get through by ignoring this mechanic. The stages in this game are generally a lot more linear and focused than Dynasty Warriors games from the era, forcing you down a path with more frequent and exciting encounters instead of wandering aimlessly on an open map with nothing in it. The stages are also mercifully shorter to complete, giving the game better pacing overall as the action is delivered to you in a small, digestible, yet exciting chunk. These stages also have unique gameplay gimmicks or environmental hazards much more frequently than Koei's competition from the era. Enemies are also a lot more creative and varied, with the usual fare you're used to from other Musou games, but with some strange ones thrown in, like these guys that swing around massive battering rams or wrecking balls. You might have just fought your way through a horde of samurai and all of a sudden a clockwork Imperial Walker comes out of nowhere. It's little moments like that while you're progressing through a stage and you say to yourself, "Wait, what the hell is that enemy doing?" And that really just sells you on the batshit insanity of this game. This only gets more pronounced as the series goes on. There isn't much to be said in terms of a story for a game like this, considering each character has their own route, where events play out in their own separate continuity, each event having no impact on the overall status quo of the game world, similar to a fighting game. The events are loosely based off history with their own unique flair, while the characters are a single quirk or personality trait extrapolated to near caricature status. They're all basically a one-note joke that just keeps repeating. The fun and enjoyment coming from the different scenarios where the characters interact and those gimmicks bounce off of each other. Honestly, the characters, in terms of design and their one-note personality gimmicks, are one of the most fun things about Basara. Starting off, we have Sanada Yukimura. He's your typical young, brash, hot-headed shonen protagonist, and his foolishness and recklessness is part of the joke and his appeal. They decided to pair him up with Takeda Shingen, with the latter serving as his mentor and role model. In actual history, the Sanada brothers worked with Takeda Shingen briefly until he was defeated by Oda Nobunaga, then became their own faction. Yukimura was extremely highly regarded by other samurai, acquiring such titles and accolades as a warrior who appears once in 100 years, and the number one warrior in Japan. After a series of disagreements and backstabbings, he ended up opposing Ieyasu Tokugawa at the end of the Sekigahara campaign, and managed to mount a defense against an insurmountable siege until he finally met his end at the hands of Ieyasu's forces in 1615. The other sort of protagonist we have for Basara is Date Masamune, an appropriate choice. While not one of the people who would end up conquering Japan, he is one of the most iconic and recognizable samurai. He's young and cocky and strikes fear into the older, more experienced generals because of how capable he ends up being. He's this real wild card that throws off the war completely wherever he goes. Second only to Shingen or Nobunaga, Masamune is featured in more samurai fiction and other video games than anyone else I can think of. It makes sense for him to be portrayed as a young man here in the game because that's where his military exploits started. His first taste of combat came when he was only 14 years old and serving under his father, Date Teramune. Smallpox claimed the sight in his right eye when he was a young boy, and after he succeeded his father, he asked his retainer, Katakura Kojiro, to remove his useless eye, earning him the nickname of Dokken Ganryu, the One-Eyed Dragon. In this game, he's voiced by the legendary Kazuya Nakai, who does an awesome job with this larger-than-life performance. He and Yamamoto decided that Masamune's dialogue would have randomly inserted English lines, something that definitely caused confusion among the staff. Yamamoto using the excuse that the Date clan must have engaged in a lot of foreign diplomacy around this time, and I don't really buy that. But at this point, it's a quirk of the character that's just so iconic, it wouldn't be the same without it. Takeda Shingen has a rival as well in the form of Uesugi Kenshin, probably due to their historical battle at Kawanakajima. He's portrayed with this elegance and grace about him, like he has a delicate and fragile appearance on the outside, but is a strategic and calculated tactician on the inside. Similar to Shingen and Yukimura shouting each other's names and punching each other in the face every time there's a bonding moment between them, Kenshin's character quirk is his relationship with his lady ninja Kasuga, where every time he speaks to her, she melts into a puddle and fantasizes about their hypothetical romance. Kenshin's gameplay is very fast and agile, but he doesn't have nearly as much health as some of the other characters. He and Kasuga have their movesets copied by two other characters. Or maybe it's the other way around and they're the clone characters. It's one of those chicken before the egg scenarios and we'll never really know which came first. All I know is that clone characters are one of those things that Musou fans can't stand because it begs the question of why have that character be playable at all if they're just a copy of someone else. If I recall correctly though, this will be the last time this will happen for the rest of the Basara series, although I can't say the same for some of the other Musou games we're going to be covering. Kasuga has her gameplay copied from the Takeda ninja Sarutobi Sasuke, and Kenshin has his copied by Matsu, the wife of Maeda Toshie. I find the game's portrayal of Toshie very curious considering in actual history he was an incredibly influential player, being one of Nobunaga's allies and one of Hideyoshi's retainers and loyalists after his death. Here in Basara, the Maeda clan lived this backwater country lifestyle surrounded by crops and farm animals, with Toshie running around without his shirt off and basically using a pitchfork as a weapon. The Maeda stages throughout the series always end up being full of unusual gimmicks as well, usually revolving around Toshie and Matsu being separated and then stronger once united. In another instance of What the Hell Japan, we have Xavi. He's based off of Saint Francis Xavier, a very influential Spanish missionary who traveled to Japan during this time to spread Christianity to their culture. In the game, Xavi is portrayed as a bizarre cult leader where all his followers adopt the same Three Stooges haircut and follow the religion of Xaviism. It's hilarious and honestly very fitting.
Xavi journeyed down the long road, preaching his beliefs. It was a road that led to glory, the glory of love. A road occasionally wrought with peril. Yet his belief held fast.
Zavi uses cannons in gameplay, which sounds fun, and it is, but he's a bit clunky and limited on movement. Nobunaga's wife, Lady Nohime, is a much better character to use if you want to play as someone who uses guns. She's a lot more agile. Speaking of completely over-the-top nonsense, we have Honda Tadakatsu. In development, Yamamoto wanted to put heavy emphasis on him being the strongest warrior in the land, the Lu Bu equivalent for the series, but took it so far over the top we ended up with a mecha samurai. He even has funnels! I mentioned before that this video is actually a remake, and in fact, a video on Sengoku Basara was my very first attempt at making a video essay style video back in like 2018 or so, and it's hella cringe and overblown with self-importance, and it will never see the light of day again. One of the things I said hyperbolically in that video is that Basara was head and shoulders better than Dynasty Warriors and Samurai Warriors, and that comment never quite sat right with me because I genuinely didn't know back then if that was actually true. So I tracked down a copy of Samurai Warriors and played it just for this video. How does Basara compare to it? Well, I'm going to be a bit biased here, but I promise that I've included as many objective points as I can. The original Samurai Warriors is actually a fine game, and I do recommend going back and playing it if you're a Musou fan. But, in fact, it does not hold a candle to Basara. The gameplay is more simplistic and less satisfying, the environments are open but they're bland, drab, colorless, and lacking in detail. There's only 5 characters available to play as from the beginning, whereas Basara let you play as somewhere in the ballpark of 12 out of the 16 immediately at the start. The music is inferior and doesn't make any effort to match the tone and the setting like Basara does, and the character designs are good but uninspired compared to Basara. Samurai Warriors, like all Musou games, is crazy, silly, and over the top as well, but Capcom must have seen the formula and went, no, we gotta go even bigger than that. Yukimura wields a spear? No, give him 2 spears at once. Masamune has to hold all 6 of his swords between his fingers like they're his dragon talons because, you know, one-eyed dragon. Akechi Mitsuhide can't just be a swishy, handsome man, he needs to be a real slimy bastard. Really lay it on the nose that he's a backstabber and a double crosser. Samurai Warriors designs are fine, but much of it just lacks personality, and there's nothing nearly as over the top as Zavi or Mecha Tadakatsu. I really don't think there's even a case to be made in terms of plagiarism either. I've already sort of debunked that, and even in the worst case scenario where Basara is a blatant and intentional ripoff, it wouldn't be the first or the last time that games with identical premises and identical genres would exist simultaneously alongside each other with no one batting an eye. Hell, if the Call of Duty and Battlefield games can exist alongside each other, then we sure as hell don't have a problem here. Bottom line, both games deserve to exist, even if I think Basara is better due to reasons that will seem preferential to some and objective to others.
Basara is a wild ride, and I would argue it was the best Musou game to date at the time of its release. It was successful enough to garner a sequel, an anime adaptation, and an English localization, but unfortunately for the latter, Capcom just couldn't leave it well enough alone.
Whenever the subject of Devil Kings is brought up, the reaction from a fan of Basara is usually a groan, followed by some vitriolic comment, with some going so far as to say it's the reason the series never took off in the West. The perplexing part about it is the Devil Kings actually got pretty decent review scores from mainstream critics at the time.
So, why do so many fans hate this game so much? Is it just a bad localization, or is there more to it than that?
If you consume any media from different parts of the world, you're no doubt extremely familiar with localization changes, for better and for worse, and there's an ever-ongoing debate as to whether or not these changes are good or even necessary. Certain things are changed due to being baked in so much cultural context that they don't make sense and would be alienating to a foreign audience. Other things are changed due to cultural sensitivity, as to not offend certain groups of people. The localization changes made to Devil Kings appear to be made purely due to marketing decisions made on a coin flip, but we'll get to that. The first thing they did was remove the song Crosswise by TM Revolution from the intro. Even if you're not familiar with the group by name, you're probably familiar with Takanori Nishikawa's iconic vibrato from many an anime opening, like Gundam Seed and Soul Eater. Nishikawa and his band lend their performances to every game in the Basara series, and it's one of the most awesome and badass things about every game and always sets the mood for the experience. But nope, get that out of the English version. Can't have none of that J-Rock nonsense over in America, right? The presentation sucks this time around too, with all the color and style sucked out of the menus. No more artistic watercolor portraits of the characters. It's bland, drab earth tones for the menus. The new menu music is uninspired too. The elephant in the room when it comes to the localization changes is the names. Alright here, so Nobunaga's called Devil King. That kind of makes sense for his character. I mean, a lot of times he's called the Devil King of the Sixth Heaven, so I guess I can't complain about that one. Let's see, Azure Dragon? Okay, that one's not bad either. It kind of makes sense. Red Minotaur? Okay, yeah. It gets a lot worse from here. Scorpio? Fucking Scorpio? Really?
Scorpio!
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 You may also notice that Kasuga, now known as Venus, is unlocked from the start, whereas Kenshin, now known as Frost, is the unlockable character, which is the other way around from the Japanese version. Once you pick a character and select a stage, you notice the biggest and most egregious localization change awaits you. This game doesn't actually take place in Japan at all. If you're scratching your head wondering how that's possible, they made up an entirely fictional continent for this battle to take place in, and reskinned a lot of the different warriors' units to look like they're from different cultures around the world and different points in history. It's really bizarre, but you can't scrub all the samurai references out of this game because the cutscenes still remain intact, and gee, I hope no one in the West happens to recognize the Oda clan emblem or the Date one. But all this could just be pointless nitpicks if the gameplay was still the same, right? They couldn't even leave that alone either. They took away the secondary heavy attacks, or the arts, and replaced it with a secondary combo attack that puts enemies in a stunned state, and this really throws off the pace and tempo of the combat. They changed how the Basara attack works too. Masamune doesn't even get his Basara attack. All he gets is War Dance, which is an ability you could just use at any time with Triangle once you unlocked it.
So it looks worse, sounds worse, and plays worse. It's just such a baffling version of the game. Like, why did they decide to localize it this way? Why not just translate the text into English and release it the way it was? Why did they think they couldn't market a samurai game? Why go for this generic fantasy game? And why market it as this adjacent property to Devil May Cry? They even have the same font. But if it's the only means you have for actually playing Basara 1, you could do worse. It's actually not that bad, and it's kind of an uncommon game to find in the wild, so if you see a copy of it, maybe pick it up for cheap just to experience Basara 1 and to see what this weird result was like. But by far and a mile, the optimal way of playing Basara 1 is on the PlayStation 3 HD collection, which includes it, Basara 2, and its expansion, Two Heroes. And if you consider the pedigree of games that got HD collections back in the 7th generation, like Ratchet & Clank, and Sly Cooper, and Shadow of the Colossus, and Metal Gear Solid, and God of War, and Splinter Cell, and Prince of Persia, it really just kind of puts into perspective how well-loved this series was in Japan at the time. I don't see any other Musou game series getting HD collections, certainly not Dynasty Warriors or Samurai Warriors. God forbid anybody actually wants to go back and play these older Musou games. And I feel like that is proof alone that this game holds up as well as it does. I am extremely grateful that I got to enjoy this game's fanbase when it was in its peak popularity back in 2011, 2012. Basara 3 was coming out, the second season of the anime was wrapping up, and the movie was coming right around the corner. I made a few friends purely by virtue of being a fan of this series, and in some cases, they are some people that I'll probably never have a chance to speak to again, but regardless of that, I will always cherish the memories.
There is so much more I have to say about Basara, and so there are many more videos on the future games in the series to come. I also have a great deal to say about the Basara anime and movie as well. If you enjoy these Musou videos but feel like they take entirely too long to come out, consider following us on Twitch. I'm going to have to record footage for all the future games in this series either way, so it makes sense to just stream it in the process, and you get to hear my thoughts about the game raw while I'm playing it, and get a behind-the-scenes look at the production of these videos.
So, what's next for this series? Well, we will be discussing Basara 2 and 2 Heroes in a later video, but I want to take a break from talking about Musou games set in the past and set our sights to the future. The far future, from after the bombs have fallen, and the only currency of any value in this wasteland is strength. Till next time.